وكذلك أوحينا إليك روحا من أمرنا ما كنت تدري ما الكتاب ولا الإيمان ولكن جعلناه نورا نهدي به من نشاء من عبادنا وإنك لتهدي إلى صراط مستقيم صراط الله الذي له ما في السماوات وما في الأرض ألا إلى الله تصير الأمور.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome to another episode of the program, Muslims in America. The religion of Islam is the fastest growing religion in the world, and the majority of that growth is taking place right here in the United States of America. According to most reliable estimates, there are more than 7 million Muslims living in the United States of America. Muslims have become valuable and vital assets to the American society. So please join me as I travel around America and introduce you to a few of the many Muslims in America. And welcome back to the program, Muslims in America. Today we're in East Orange, New Jersey, which is about 20 minutes from New York City. And alhamdulillah, I'm joined by two elders here in the East Orange Islamic community. I'm joined by Imam Ahmed Brahani and Wayuddin Sharif. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah.
And welcome to the program. I'm really glad that I'm able to spend some time with our elders in Islam to talk a bit about the history of Islam, because it's an important history to document how Islam got started so we know some of the roots of Islam in America. So, Ahmed, just tell us a bit about yourself and how you came to Islam.
Well, I became interested in Islam in my early years in elementary school. Mm-hmm. And I was doing research on religions, and by way of studying world religions and whatnot, mm-hmm. I became introduced to some of the dominant religions in Africa, Asia, the Middle East, and whatnot, and I compared those religions to traditional religions here in the United States. And Islam just kind of made sense to me from the perspective that I had from being made more sense to me from the perspective that I had as being raised a Baptist from a Christian family and whatnot. Mm-hmm. Kind of found out that that was a time, of course, when there was people were looking for their roots and their heritage and those kinds of things. Mm-hmm. And it appeared to me that Islam was the dominant religion in Africa. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, it kind of made one and two, and I started to pursue more information and knowledge about Islam, and ultimately I embraced Islam.
Alhamdulillah. And what was it like? I mean, in those days when you became Muslim, what was the Islamic environment like? I mean, what was how many Muslims were there at that time?
Oh, Muslims were very scarce in the time that I, you know, started to try to find something out about Islam. In my research, you know, I used to look at, you know, National Geographic magazines and things like that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I was looking for traditional Islam. I didn't know I was looking for that, but that's what I was looking for. But at that time, you know, there weren't many masajids as we would find today.
Where were you living at that time?
I was living in the city of Newark in New Jersey.
Right.
And at that time, the only organization that really existed where you could find something about or something that had the name of Islam connected to it was the Nation of Islam at that time, mm-hmm. under the leadership of Elijah Muhammad. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, at that time, you know, I kind of went that way. I went that way, actually. And because it had a lot of the familiar phrases that were connected with Islam, such as Islam and Muslim, and salam alaikum, mm-hmm. and we pray five times a day, and with those kinds of things, you know, I went to that because that's what was available to me.
Mm-hmm. And how did you make the transition from that to the Islam which you understand today?
Well, it's interesting because, you know, and at that time, you know, there weren't any resources hardly available. Mm-hmm. But one thing, and I always talk about this to people, You know, it was very customary to greet people and say, Assalamu alaikum.
Mm-hmm. I just want to stop you on that point. Let me ask you, in the community at large that weren't Muslim and they would hear Muslims say Assalamu alaikum, what was the reaction of the people when they heard these people from their own neighborhoods speaking a language they knew nothing about? And you knew these Arabic phrases and words and...
Oh, they would ridicule you, you know, mm-hmm. they would, you know, make jokes about what you're saying and why you're saying, or are you speaking tongues, or mm-hmm. are you speaking, you know, another language, what kind of language is that and whatnot, you mm-hmm. know. Mm-hmm.
Okay, and so, I mean, I was asking you how you made the transition from the Nation of Islam to the Islam which you are on today.
Well, it became... The issue that made me become, you know, interested in this, I was still searching. I was searching for, you know, what is Islam, you know. Mm. And one of the things that was very, very customary, as it is all over the Muslim world, is to say Assalamu alaikum when you meet somebody. Mm-hmm. And, of course, the reply is Wa alaikum salam. Mm-hmm. And, of course, that's the Arabic language. Mm-hmm. And as a result of using that phrase, it inspired me to want to know something more than Assalamu alaikum. Mm-hmm. And so I started to learn Arabic. Mm-hmm. And in my study of Arabic, I learned more about the religion of Islam mm-hmm. and, you know, different aspects of Islam. Mm-hmm. And so it was the vehicle, Arabic became the vehicle by which that, you know, I became introduced to traditional Islam. Mm-hmm.
And now you said you came from a family which is from a Baptist background. I mean, what was their reaction when you told them that you were going to become a Muslim?
Well, my family wasn't very well educated. Mm-hmm. So it was something strange and new to them. And they didn't understand it, but they didn't criticize me or make it difficult for me. Mm-hmm. I think I probably made it more difficult for them mm-hmm. because, you know, being young and enthusiastic and whatnot, I wanted, you know, everybody to become a Muslim, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I kind of put my parents through, you know, a test, mm-hmm. as it were, you know, in terms of trying to expose them to what little bit I knew about Islam. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Akhi, what you did?
Again, thank you for having us here. Appreciate it. Thank Allah much. My entry to Islam was very similar to Imam Burhani's Islam entry, and that was, again, through understanding a little bit about Islam. I was in high school. I was, again, probably 18 years old, 17 years old at the time. And my first inquiry into Islam really came as a result of me reading the autobiography of Malcolm X. Mm-hmm. And upon reading some of that and upon actually attending a couple of meetings that I attended, I became interested, and at the same time I began to ask questions about religion in general, mm-hmm. questions that kind of posed some difficulty for my parents to answer, mm-hmm. as well as some other individuals that were part of the church. Mm-hmm. And so they kind of directed me to ask questions of other places. So I actually ended up going to the temple mm-hmm. and inquiring a little bit about Islam as mm-hmm. a result of that. Right. Ahmed Burhani was there at the temple at the time, and I was on my way to college mm-hmm. when I entered into Islam. So I continued my inquiry into Islam as a result of just being interested in learning more about not just, you know, the religious aspects of Islam, but how Islam also can promote some social change mm-hmm. within what I considered to be some of the oppression that particularly African American people in the community were suffering. So my entry to Islam was, again, through the Nation of Islam, mm-hmm. through understanding about what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's program was like mm-hmm. and how that was promoted within the community on the basis of, again, the Islamic tones that were being promoted by mm-hmm. the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and others.
Right. And just to get some historical perspective, when you say temple, tell mm-hmm. us what it was like in the temple. What was going on in the temple?
Well, there were a number of things going on. I think the primary thing that was going on in the temple, though, was a matter of learning about self. Mm-hmm. There was a lot of identification with who we were, what our history happened to be, learning a little bit about our social responsibility in terms of how we as young people had an obligation and a duty to promote some change within the society, and that change would produce an opportunity for particularly African-American people within the community to advance mm-hmm. educationally, economically. Wasn't so much a political aspiration, but certainly the program that we were in that was focused on social change and economic change.
Mm-hmm. And what were the aspects of worship that took place there? You know, we have the Salah in Islam. What was the form of the Salah in the temple?
Well, it were basically, by and large, for the most part, there was no formal Salah as we know it is today.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, the prayers that were taught were basically supplications.
Mm-hmm.
You know, everyone learned, you know, Al-Fatiha.
Mm-hmm.
You learned it in English. And if you were enthusiastic, you learned it in Arabic.
Mm-hmm.
But beyond that scope, there wasn't a great deal of emphasis placed on Salah as we know it.
Mm-hmm.
However, in some of the institutions that were part of the Nation of Islam at that time, there were places wherein individuals and people were making Salah.
Mm-hmm.
And Arabic was taught in some of the elementary schools. Some of the teachers actually, one particular person who I remember vividly, Akbar Muhammad, who happens to be the brother of Imam Warfuddin Muhammad.
Mm-hmm.
He studied in Egypt, of course. And then there was another brother named Ahmed Dhafer,
mm-hmm.
who actually studied in and had a PhD mm-hmm. from both Saudi Arabia and Kuwait in Islamic jurisprudence.
Mm-hmm.
And he taught in one of the schools in Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
He taught Arabic language, he taught prayers, he taught Islamic fiqh, you know, and those kinds of things.
Mm-hmm. And this was all being done at the same time that the Nation of Islam was
exactly,
around.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And this, however, this was later on. This was much later on. We're talking about 1975, 1977, however.
Mm-hmm.
And this is like the almost transitional period
right.
mm-hmm. from the Nation of Islam becoming, if you will, the world community of Islam.
Well, tell me a bit about your transition from the Nation of Islam to the world.
And what Imam Ahmed Barhani pointed out, the 1975 period was the period when, after the Honorable Elijah Muhammad had passed, his son, Imam W. Deen Muhammad, became the leader of the Nation of Islam. And it was through his encouragement to mm-hmm. learn about the religion that many of us began to migrate and to direct our attention to learning Arabic. As a matter of fact, Ahmed was kind of like on his way already. He knew a lot of the Arabic, and many of us, like myself, became students of his
mm-hmm.
in terms of learning the Arabic language and learning a lot about the principles of Islam.
Mm-hmm.
But it was the encouragement of Imam W.D. Muhammad that at least inspired me to become more astute, you know, and to become a student of the religion. There were other people like Maceo Aziz, who also had learned the language and was conducting many classes with those, and I became one of his students as well.
Mm-hmm.
And it was people like that that actually encouraged us to learn more about
the religion. But it's kind of fair to say that once the Muslims in America started to learn the Arabic language, then whatever the beliefs of the Nation of Islam, they just couldn't hold in much water anymore once
exactly.
people started mm-hmm. to study Islam.
Yeah, the social movement became one of more, an organization that was basically a social mm-hmm. reformation movement,
mm-hmm.
you know, became, or it was on its way by metamorphosis, really, to mm-hmm. become a religious organization, if you will, or an organization that placed its foundation, as it were, on the principles and beliefs that Islam, you know, as taught, you know, as provided, you know, in Sunni Islam or Orthodox Islam, if you will, provide us with. You
know. I think it's important to point out also that the Nation of Islam created human relationships that also kind of transcended the transition. And, you know, we moved from the temple environment into the environment now that is masjid,
mm-hmm.
all right? And I think many people held on to those relationships that they had in the temple.
Mm-hmm.
And because we had this common background and because we had this feeling of wanting to stay as a family, many of us also moved as a family into this new phase of Islamic growth,
mm-hmm.
which in some instances, even today, those relationships still exist.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'd like to move on in the discussion mm-hmm. here. But before we do, when we talk about the Nation of Islam today, Some people outside might think it's a huge entity. But what is the ratio of Muslims who are actually in the Nation of Islam and Muslims who are actually practicing the correct Islam?
Well, you know, I mean, the term Nation of Islam was one that was coined, you know, by the founder of the Nation of Islam.
But I'm saying someone who's from outside of America, yeah, he's Nation of Islam, he thinks of some huge
No. It was something that was coined to give particularly African-Americans an identity, or people who didn't have an identity, to let them know that you belong to an organization. You, as a Muslim, you're part of the Ummah, if you will, the nation, the worldwide nation of Islam. You know, meaning all of the Muslims all over the world, not just that small group. But at that time, most people who were part of that organization believed that, that they were that nation, if you will, as opposed to a part of the global nation of Islam.
And back to the other part of the question, today. Do they represent a small minority or a big majority of the indigenous Muslims here in America?
I think it's a small minority. I think the majority of those persons who were part of what was called at that time the Lost Found Nation of Islam, that's the actual official name of the Lost Found Nation of Islam, have matured, they've developed, and they've found themselves now part of masajid and centers that practice the universal Islam that every Muslim throughout the world practices. So I think the very small minority of people hold on to perhaps some of those practices that were then a part of the Lost Foundation of Islam.
Right. And alhamdulillah, we're sitting here in a big masjid with a big school, but you know, that all had a start in some other smaller places. So I wonder, you gentlemen, just to talk to me a bit about the establishment of this community and what the Islamic environment was in this area. You know, how many masjids, how many Muslims were actually in this area. So tell us about the origins of this community here.
Well, in the year 1981, I was working in the city of Newark as a teacher in the Muslim school there, Clara Muhammad School. I was one of the teachers there. I was teaching Arabic language and some things about Islam. And this was actually part of the a transition from the Nation of Islam to the leadership of Imam Waruthuddin Muhammad. Okay, this was a transitional period. And during this transitional period, there were a lot of changes taking place. And some people were eager to change, and others were less eager to change. Some people wanted to change, and some people didn't want to change or change, you know, rapidly. With that came about a decision that had to be made as to who was going to be the person who would function as the teacher for the mosque there in Newark. And it was decided that I wouldn't be able to function in that role and that I had the ability to, you know, find whatever I wanted to do. So I decided to come to East Orange and set up a school, if you will, to teach Arabic language and Islamic studies. And so in 1981, I took it on myself, actually, and my wife at that time, to find a place. And we located a second floor loft at 239 Central Avenue, actually, in 1981. And I took what little money I had, and I put down a down payment of about $100 to secure the building, or the loft, as it were. And that was the start of the Islamic Center of East Orange, if you will, today, Masjid Ahl-Sunnah.
And now at that time, when you established that building, were the other masajid in the area, or this was like one of the few places?
Actually, in East Orange, at that particular time, we were the only functioning masjid in the city of East Orange,
And what was the size of the community at that time?
We had on record about roughly 100 families at that time that were actually supporters and active and participating in our activities there. Those 100 families basically were, you know, the support for our efforts here in East Orange.